Alaska boasts 17 of the top 20 tallest mountains in the country. The towering mountains in a 600-mile-long Alaska range are home to some of the toughest terrain and coldest weather in Alaska. The peak of Denali can reach a frigid negative 75 degrees. U.S. Army Alaska's massive Chinook helicopter is one of the only aircraft that can fly to and land at these extreme altitudes. The Chinook has a special feature to land on any rugged Alaskan terrain: giant skis that surround the wheels.
We can land in things that normally the helicopter would sink into. We displace a whole lot of weight down to 2 pounds per square inch versus 200 pounds per square inch on tires.
These skis, made right here in Alaska, are constructed out of fiberglass, one of the toughest materials around.
Fiberglass is made up of a fabric with all these glass shards going different directions. It has changed through the years to smaller glass particles, to different weaves. Even more so than so many of the composites that are more popular today, fiberglass has the greatest propensity for temperature variation. 50 below to 100 above, you're not going to have a problem with fiberglass.
I'll let you know we've got a good transfer.
For this mission, the 152 Battalion will prepare for a severe situation, turning off the rotors at high altitudes. When the Chinook's engine is running, the blades spin at a staggering 6,000 RPM. This keeps the massive 360-pound blades straight out. But an emergency shutdown event at high altitudes could be disastrous. Extreme winds and weather can cause the blades to bounce and damage the aircraft.
We're the only high-altitude train team in the Army right now. We're the only ones that can know how to operate in the mountainous terrain with the snow, and we have to be ready for any mission at any point in time.
Today's HLZ, or high landing zone, is more than 70 miles away from Fort Wainwright, where the mountain winds can become strong enough to break a tree.
And we've got a bunch of different HLZs that we're going to be hitting today. Some of them 7,000, some of them 8,600.
There is some winds, 25 gusting to 35 once we get out there on the flat, so we'll monitor the winds and we'll adjust accordingly.
That's really the hands-on experience, getting soldiers, pilots out and flying in this environment.
Testing the boundaries of the Chinook now, when there's no emergency, ensures they'll be prepared for anything when lives are on the line.
If we can find a couple areas where the wind's not beating us too bad, there's a good spot right there, that ridge right there.
Yep. Here in the mountains, you never know what you're gonna get. It could be crystal clear skies, no winds blowing, and then all of a sudden you've got 30 mile per hour winds blowing at you.
Looking good. You're clear down on the right.
The troops land successfully and power down the engines.
Pick back the power switches off, just waiting for the rotors to stop.
But the blades don't stop spinning.
We started getting 30 and 40 mile per hour winds at the left side of the aircraft.
The wind is more intense than the troops were expecting. It's pushing the 360-pound blades. Even at this slow speed, they could do some serious damage.
If you start getting little downdrafts on top of the aircraft, it could cause our 360-pound blades to slam into the top of the airframe and damage major flight critical components.
Do you need me to stop them?
It takes the strength of every soldier on board to stop these massive blades by hand and tie them down.
Everything I had in my hands, I threw it down and started running for blade ropes and yelling, trying to get people to get a hold of a blade. We grabbed hold of the blades, kind of stabilized the blades long enough for somebody to get blade ropes out.
The crew is finally able to stabilize the blades and prevent any major damage to the Chinook. But now they have an even bigger challenge to face. If they start up the engines and a gust of wind comes along before the engine's fully powered up, it could spell disaster.
Prior to that rotor getting to 100% RPM, it is really susceptible to wind gusts and it starts to bounce. And if it bounces at the wrong time, it can actually contact the fuselage.
We're gonna start one of the engines as quick as possible and go to flight quick as possible. And when you feel that lull, let me know. I'm gonna have my hand on the starter button already.
If they can't find a way to safely get the Chinook blades fully powered up, they'll be trapped on this mountaintop until another aircraft arrives from Fort Wainwright, more than 70 miles away.
Secondary plan is if it doesn't go well, we'll do an emergency engine shutdown. And at that point, the only thing we can do is make a call so that somebody knows where we're at.
The soldiers must time starting up the engine perfectly. Chief Donovan will be relying on Specialist Hill to let him know when it's safe.
If we say, hey, we gotta go right now, that means right now.
When Specialist Hill thinks they have a long enough break in the wind, he'll signal Chief Donovan and remove the ropes holding down the blades as quickly as he can, and hope the lull is long enough to get the rotors to 100% RPM.
Really, all it takes is approximately about 20 seconds to 30 seconds to get it up to a point where it's safe.
Specialist Hill waits patiently for a break in the wind.
It's just a coin toss, more or less, if we're gonna get it started in enough time.
Finally, Specialist Hill thinks he has his chance.
This is low right now, I think we're good, sir.
He signals Chief Donovan to start up the engines.
All right, start one and two.
Cargo pressure ready on two.
The wind holds off long enough for the Chinook's engines to fully power up.
As it started to speed up, I kind of had a little bit of a sigh of relief, like, thank goodness, it's finally, we're good.
The soldiers and the Chinook make it safely into the air. They're homeward bound, having successfully performed this dangerous mission.
It was definitely a challenge, but it was a good challenge. Not anywhere else would you have to do that. The training we do in Alaska to make us be able to withstand the Arctic, it means we have adapted and can survive in any climate, any temperature, at any place, and can do any mission at any point in time.